Each year, the college hosts provocative speakers from a wide variety of backgrounds and multiple perspectives, which correspond with one of the core pillars of GUC: scholarship, leadership, creativity, and service. This generates new thinking, productive discussions, and the rare opportunity for future serving leaders to meet some of the most remarkable human beings alive. Today's pillar of focus is leadership. There are many perspectives on what leadership truly means, but many of us can attest good leadership to a few characteristics, including self-awareness, self-direction, vision, the ability to motivate, and social awareness. Our speaker is a remarkable example of a true leader. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Grizzly Growl. At this time, I would like to invite Jessica Kerrigan, President of the GDC Law Society, to introduce our speaker for the day.
Good afternoon, guests and fellow Grizzlies. My name is Jessica Kerrigan, and as Georgia Gwinnett's current president of the Law Society, you cannot imagine how honored I am to be here this afternoon to introduce such an influential leader. To try and condense Glenda Hatchett's career and her role in leadership positions within a few minutes seemed like a tough task at first. After her undergraduate in political science at Mount Holyoke College, Hatchett attended Emory University of Law, where she eventually was named the Outstanding Alumni of the Year and honored with the Emory Medal, Emory's highest alumni award. Once Hatchett completed law school, she worked on a coveted federal clerkship in the United States District Court in the Northern District of Georgia, followed by a position at Delta Airlines. At Delta, Hatchett became the airline's highest ranking woman of color, serving both as a senior attorney and public relations manager. During her 10 years at Delta, Hatchett litigated cases in federal courts throughout the country and supervised global crisis management, when she was recognized by Ebony Magazine as one of the 100 best and brightest black women in corporate America in 1990. That same year, Hatchett made a difficult decision to leave Delta Airlines in order to accept the appointment as chief presiding judge of Fulton County Juvenile Court, where she became Georgia's first African-American chief presiding judge of the state court and the department head of one of the largest juvenile court systems in the country. In 2000, Hatchett became presiding over the nationally syndicated TV show, Judge Hatchett, that went on for 8 seasons. After a long, successful run with Sony Television, Hatchett is coming out with a new TV show, The Verdict of Judge Hatchett, that will premiere this fall on Justice Central TV. The Hatchett firm was launched in 2014, a national law firm that focuses on catastrophic personal injury, medical malpractice, and class action lawsuits. On July 11th this year, Hatchett's law firm announced that they would be representing the family of Philando Castile, an African-American man who was fatally shot on July 6th in St. Paul, Minnesota, in the civil legal matters. Leaders help themselves and others do the right things. They set a direction, build an inspiring vision, and create something new. Great leaders know that in order to be in charge, the relationship you have with others is all about giving and serving with ambition and good attitude. Leadership is all about mapping out where you need to go to win as a team or as an organization. It is a dynamic, exciting, and inspiring process to lead a team with the right example. Now, it is a Grizzly Growl tradition that before the speaker comes up, we all growl on this occasion. That means no clapping, so Georgia Gwinnett College, let's give Glenda Hatchett a fierce Grizzly Growl.
Started today, and what an impressive group of boring lectures. You know, people come, leadership, climb every mountain, forge every stone. We're not doing that today. But rather, I hope will be a very thought-provoking discussion. And therefore, I'm going to ask you not to tape it except for the official people taping. And the reason I do that is because I need to be candid. I need to be candid about some things I'm saying today. And I don't want, things in context showing up on social media, quite frankly. So if we could kind of have that understanding of no taping, I would really, really, really appreciate it. I want to come from a place of purpose and passion, which seems strange if I'm going to be talking about leadership. And I love those four pillars of scholarship and leadership and service and creativity. And I think that's a powerful statement for this institution. And I am so honored to be asked to come today to speak from the direction, particularly of leadership. But I'm going to be candid with you. You can't lead unless you're willing to serve. You can't lead unless you're willing to serve. And that the mark of true leadership are people who really are pouring themselves into it and are doing it for the good of the greater body, not just for their own ego or for to be noticed, but really people who have the best interest of the community, of the people at heart. But before that, I even want to back up one step beyond that, before that, is that you can't lead somebody unless you're clear about who you are. You've got to be clear about who you are. And so, I'm going to challenge us today. If you think you're just going to be here and sitting and listening to a lecture, wrong. I'm going to challenge you today. This is going to involve all of us. And so, a few years ago, there was a famous book called Lean In. And my counter to that was that you can't lean in unless you're anchored. Because if you're not anchored and you try to lean in, you're going to fall over. And so you've got to be clear about who you are and to whom you belong. In my situation, I am clear. I am clear that I stand here today before you because I stand on the shoulders of mighty, mighty, mighty generations. And so I also need you to read this. Yes, somebody. I'm Black and Baptist. Which means I have to move around. Thank you. This is going to go too. Right, we're back. But I'm clear about it, though, because I know that I didn't get to this place on my own. That millions and millions of people have seen me over these years on television. I am blessed to have this new show, as Jessica talked about, that will premiere on September 12th. But I don't get it twisted. I am here because I stand on the shoulders of mighty, mighty, mighty generations of people who sacrificed for me to be able to be here, to do what I'm doing at this point in my life. And I never forget that. And so, I'm a storyteller, and I'm going to tell some stories today. I'm going to start with a story, I'm going to end with a story. But I just challenge all of us to really look deep into our souls, to really think about who we are, to whom we belong, and what our purpose and passion is in life. Because again, you can't be a great leader unless you're clear about who you are. And I'm going to talk some about leadership as well. So I thought it might be helpful to talk about my journey and how I got to where I am, because I was never, y'all understand, never worldwide, any color, African American, Hispanic, Asian, Indian. I mean, I was the highest ranking woman of color there. And I planned to be there all of my career until my goal was to be a senior vice president by the time I retired and be on the board. But, you know, my life took a very, very different turn. I had not even been inside of a juvenile court before. And then Judge Powell, who was this amazing woman, who had been a civil rights lawyer before she became a judge, was the juvenile court judge in Fulton County, and she died. And so someone I really respected called me and said, Glenda, I need to talk to you. We've been talking about this. We think that you should apply to be the next judge. And I'm thinking, And so he came to my house, I invited my dad to come and meet with us. And the three of us sat in my living room, and I was honored. I really was honored, but I'm thinking, honey, no, stop, Benny. I'm not leaving my job. And that was my inner voice. I didn't say that to my dad, let's be real clear. That was my inner voice. And you have to understand that my dad, he's been gone on for more than 20 years now, and passed away suddenly, was, is, and will be throughout all of eternity my hero. And so I'm thinking, I'm not leaving my job. I'm good. I'm honored, but I'm good. So I'll be honest, I started doing one of those yo-yo prayers. God, what you want me to do? God, you really want me to give up my job? You know how much money I'm making? How much money in my 401k? You know, I mean, come on. But I was struggling. I would get up at night and sit in my rocking chair, trying to figure out. And the more I prayed about it, I realized that this was a critical junction at my life. And that maybe I was supposed to step out on faith. Apply for the job, because if it had been any other job other than juvenile court, I wouldn't have given it a second thought. But maybe if I could get my hands on a 15-year-old, then we might not see him or her in the prison system at 25, 35, 45. That maybe if I could get my hands on a young girl who could be inspired, that maybe she would understand that there was a different life other than getting pregnant by that no-good guy down the street. That maybe I could make a difference that not only would impact this generation, but their children's 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 children. And so I struggled, I'm telling you, I struggled with it, and I filled out the application. The last day it was due, I did pass it in, as I was at a point of peace, and I thought that this is what I should be doing with this phase of my life, and if I didn't do it then, I might not ever do it. So I was appointed. And now this is the story of, you know, first week, I was sworn in on October 1st. This is October 8th. And so October 1st, you gotta visualize, my mom and daddy had invited everybody they ever thought about knowing. The place was packed. Very serious, I'm putting my hand on the Bible, my children are holding the Bible. It was deep. And if I wasn't prepared for what was gonna happen to me, there's some seats right here in the front. Aaron here by now. It says special guest, you're my special guest. Make yourselves come. And the special guest can sit somewhere. So I want you to visualize with me October 8th, a beautiful morning in Atlanta, Fulton County Juvenile Court, one of the largest juvenile court systems in the country, and in walks a precious 8-year-old child. Because people think about juvenile court as children who committed some wrongful acts, they stole something, they broke into somebody's house, lady, whatever. Well, also, juvenile court has jurisdiction over children who are neglected and abused. So the door opens, and in walks this precious 8-year-old child. And he stands there in my courtroom, just trembling, as if his whole little soul had been drained from him. And I didn't know what the response should be. I didn't know, with all of my little training at Emory Law School, there was nothing. I had a federal clerkship, I had all this experience, but there was nothing in that experience I could have possibly prepared me for that moment. And so I instinctively stood up and started taking my robe off, and I was coming down to be where he is, and he was about the distance from the bench to where you are in this front row, and the bailiff is standing here, and he said, "Oh no, you can't come down here." I said, "You better get out of my way. This is my courtroom." Because see, I had been a mama a whole lot longer than I had been a judge. And I came down off that bench that morning and did the only thing I was absolutely sure of. I came down and I just got on my knees. And I took that precious 8-year-old into my arms. That day changed my life. And so I looked at him and I said, "I'm not going to lie to you," because you have to understand, he had been in a shelter since July 23rd. His mother left him and said, "I'll be back," and she never came back. And so he was holding on to hope that if he could just make it to court that morning on October 8th, the child shouldn't linger in the system from July 23rd to October 8th. I became chief judge of the court shortly after I was appointed. That was one of the first things we had there. I fixed. Child shouldn't just linger in the system. And so there he is. And when he realized she wasn't there, he stood there just trembling. And I said, "I don't know you, ladies. I don't. But I'm going to do everything in my power to find her. Can you just hold on?" Has he been holding on to that broken promise? Can you just hold on just a little bit longer? I don't know about you, but I can't imagine being 8 years old. And my mother saying, "I'll be back." And she never came back. And you don't have a mother, a father, aunt, uncle, grandmama, granddaddy, cousin, brother, sister, nobody to hold on to. So he's just holding on to this broken promise. So fast forward, I get back up on the bench, and I said, "I am issuing a warrant for her arrest, the mother's arrest, for her failure to be in here today." And, you know, there's all this mumbling, you know, thinking, "Oh, I don't know, the judge." So I said, I didn't postpone it. I didn't put it over for 3 months or 2 months or even 2 weeks. I said, "I'm resetting this today, this afternoon on my 2 o'clock calendar." Then there was a lot of mumbling, right? And then the deputy jumps up and didn't work for me very long and says, nothing. Well, all these deputy sheriffs, we got to go to the county. We ought to find her, or at the very least, we ought to try. And so there's still some more mumbling. I was new. I knew enough to bang my gavel. That meant get it done. I'm not playing in here. 1:30, they were walking up this courthouse steps with her. 1:30. I said, "Good, get her in here." She had been home, last known address, sobering up from a crack house. I said, "Get her in here. Give her some coffee." We started at 2 o'clock. Well, that got to be the joke all over the courthouse. You just said, "Give the crack mama some coffee." I didn't know. I didn't know that if you were high on crack or coffee, you got to do anything. can't go off on them, right? I mean, you know, kind of, that's kind of what they do, right? So I did it exactly right. I did it by the book. Fast forward, you know, I ordered her into drug treatment. I said, I want you in drug treatment for 30 days. We're going to review it in 45 days. You know, I'm the judge. I got this. 45-day review. I'm thinking I'm going to have this child home by Christmas. I got this. And I just ordered it, right? I just ordered it. She left. She came back. She hadn't been anywhere near a drug treatment center. Let's go in. So I said to the court reporter, we're going off the record. I figured there were some things the court of appeals ought not hear me say. And so, and I won't repeat here, but I'll paraphrase. Get in here and sit down. I don't play when it comes to children. You left this child, you left him with nothing but broken promises. If you don't get your life together, I'm going to accuse myself, assign this case to a new judge, and I am going to strongly recommend the Department of Families and Children's Services move aggressively to terminate your parental rights so he can be adopted by a family. I am not going to let him grow up in foster care. At which point she jumps up and says, he's too old to be adopted. At which point I said, and I'm not going to paraphrase this part, I said, I will come down off this bench and I will kick your ass.
Unless you are clear
so I'm going to challenge you. I tell you what I'm going to say, and be comfortable. Do I have time to do 5 minutes? I'm going to challenge you. I'm challenging you on this. Because I want you to think about where you are and what your dream is for you. And there is nobody too old to do this. When my first book came out, I was on tour in Detroit. And I looked up a long line in this bookstore in Detroit. And I look up, and there is this woman who was in her 80s. She was 83. I'll never forget that, to be exact. And I said, oh my goodness, I am so sorry. I didn't notice. We should have noticed if you were in line. We would not have had you stand in line. She said, oh no, Judge, honey, I would have stood in line for hours if I had something to tell you. And she said, I just want to tell you, I'm in law school. So I didn't know whether she was suffering from you. I'm not trying to be funny, but you know, somebody 83 years old, clearly she was having some health challenges, and she says, I'm in law school. She said, I'm in law school because of you. I'm in law school because I watch you every day. I said, you are? And then her daughter is standing next to her, who's 53 years old. And she says, yes, Judge, we're both in law school together. Well, I started crying, she's crying, we're hugging. But you're never too old to dream. Big, bold dreams. Never too old to dream big, bold dreams. And so that's the challenge. Right now, I want you to think about what it is. That one thing that you always wanted to do, and you haven't done it. Aha! Now, then I want you to think, why not? Why haven't you done it? We're talking about leading by example now. If you are stuck in a place and you haven't done what you want to do, this one thing, just one thing that you always wanted to do, and you haven't done it, why haven't you done it? I want you to think about that for a second. And then I want you to really commit to making some plans to get there. Because you don't want to look back 10 years from now, 10 months from now, 5 years from now, and say, you know, I wish I had taken that step of faith. I wish I had done this. I wish I had done it. You know how many people in this world live with regrets? That if I had only, and that's a sign of a bold leader. You know, that you're willing to really stretch. That you're willing to stretch beyond your comfort zone. And so, Naima, if you'll time us. Do I have time for a little break up? Okay, Teresa says yes. I'm gonna have to break up the groups for a minute. Okay, 5 minutes, pair up with somebody. Well, we don't have logistics, but you can't be all, you're probably gonna pair up with somebody you know. But para, I need you all to turn to each other. Teams of two for 5 minutes. And I want you to talk about a game plan and how you get to this dream. All right, I need pairs. Nobody's exempt.
I said, you can't see it.
yourself, really ask them, this is not for anybody else, this is just for you, to ask yourself, why haven't you done that thing that you wanted to do? Have you given up on your dream? Have you given up on your dream because you don't think you can do it? You're afraid of failing? Let me tell you, there's no such thing as failing. If you're trying to get it right, you're just warming up for success. Think about it. Because if you quit, we know what's going to happen, right? Bold leaders have bold dreams. So I'm just challenging you to stretch and really come up with a plan to do, if it's just a tiny thing, every day. Something that you can look at the end of the week and say, I got this done. And then the month, like, okay, I got these things done. And discipline yourself to do that. So quickly, my three golden rules, I have a lot more, but I'm gonna do these three quickly. Glenda's three golden rules. Be authentic. Don't try to be somebody else. Be you. Be who you are. Be somebody that people can rely on. Trustworthy. Don't lie to them. You give them your word, you gotta honor. Third one is, you can't lead where you're not willing to go. True leaders never point. They lead by example. Because they have done so in a way that people trust them. They trust them. And that's what true leaders do. They then, you gotta inspire people who follow. You can't hog the spotlight. Share the glory and bear the responsibility of something that will go right. And then my bonus one, I always have to throw this to my young people. Don't marry a turkey. Yeah. And you may date some. They have to kiss some bras on the way on. But don't marry somebody who doesn't believe in your dreams. Who's not going to be committed to your empowerment. How can you lead if you got to go and deal with somebody who doesn't understand the vision? You know? And if you're not strong enough to cut and loose, I don't care how fine he is. Say, Judge, I just can't be with you.
Year, I was in first grade at Anderson Park Elementary School.
because my mama was a school teacher and my daddy was an avid reader. So I knew how to read before I got the first grade. So I get the first grade and Miss O'Neill is going, see Dick once. She's right on the board every day. See Dick once, see Jane once, see Spot once, see Jane stop. I was sick of Jane, Spot, Dick, all of it. Cause Dick and Jane didn't look anything like me. Right? And so I need something, I don't have to get back. Like that reserve sign is not coming. That's good. That's rude. So every day it was the same thing. Children, we're gonna get books, but we never got books. And I hated it. I was just bored out of my mind. And my chair didn't fit, my legs would dangle. Because I couldn't touch the floor, and it was rickety and raggedy, and so it would rock. And she said, Glenda, stay still. And I'm thinking, I'm trying. This first grade stuff is not working for me. So, she only passed my books. Now, I was cool in kindergarten. Half day, punch, cookies. That red dye punch, lemon, all that been canceled now. Do the pokey pokey. At least you might imagine it's a very social child. So I was cool with that day playing with my friends. But this first grade stuff was really getting on my nerves. So she passes out the books, and we're going to read out loud. And she gets to me, Therese, and when she gets to me, my page is torn out of my book. And she passes over me. And I think that seems like a big deal, but if you are a first grader and you've been waiting on books and you've been waiting for your chance to read out loud, I remember everything about that day, including what I had. That day is etched in my soul. So I go up, the kids are all lined up to be dismissed to go out the door, and I go up to Miss O'Neill's desk and I said, Miss O'Neill, very politely, Miss O'Neill, please, I need a new book. But see, I'm about to put that nasty book in my book bag, right? And she said, well, Glenda, nobody has a new book. Well, that was my issue. Jessica, right now I'd be, trying to lobby for all of us to get books. But at six, I didn't know about Gandhi and King. I'm just trying to get a book. A new book. And this is what she said to me. She said, Glenda, and I look back now with adult eyes and I realize how hard this was for her. She said, colored children don't get books. I went to elementary school. I was in first grade after the Supreme Court decision. But somehow that decision hadn't made its way to my little elementary school in Atlanta, Georgia. And I didn't understand that. And so for you young people who are looking at me like, what in the world is she talking about? Because there's some people who are as old as I am who know what I'm talking about in this room. The books were trash. The custom was that the books were thrown out as trash and left in the dumpster on the back of white schools in the rain, in the heat all summer. And the tradition is that the colored janitors from the colored school would come over and get all of the trash and bring it to the colored schools. While the white schools got brand new books, we got these books that were thrown out. And that's why my chair didn't fit. That's why we didn't have playground equipment. That's why the crayons were in a tub and they were all nubs, because everything we had was trash. So a teacher would take a page from this book and a cover from this book, and they were doing the best they could. I didn't understand the historical equipment of this. My dad, as I told you, worked at night to care for us until my mother got home from school. nap, and then you go to work. I mean, it was just amazing sacrifice. And so I was, my dad, even as a first grader, I understood my dad was my hero. My dad could fix anything as far as I was concerned in first grade. And not to sit there talking to this woman. I just go home and tell my dad. Why is he keep doing that? So I usually walked home with my friends. I ran home that day. Busted in the house, dad, you gotta go to the school. Before Miss O'Neill leaves, I need to move on. And this is what he said. This is a lesson I want to leave with you. I said, Daddy, she said, tell the children to get up with me. He said, delicious. So I want you to go in your room and I want you to gather your crayons. And I have a little red table, two red chairs, and I want you to sit at your table. And I want you to write your own story. Oh, baby, I didn't get it at six, but I got it now. My dad and his wisdom and my mother and her wisdom knew that they couldn't let me leave that at the kindergarten about what I didn't have, that I needed to write my own story. And so that's what I challenge you to do today. It's one of the most important lessons I've ever taught. I've got to write my own story. And that's what true leaders do. They are bold, they're committed, they're tenacious, and they step out and they write their own stories, even in the midst of the dark times. And I'm gonna tell you, life's books is gonna have some torn pages, because there are gonna be pages that are torn by racism and sexism and ageism and all the kind of isms that divide us. But when you get to those pages, you gotta write your own story. And so when they tell you you can't because you are an immigrant, they tell you you can't because you're African American, they tell you you can't because you were raised poor, they tell you you can't because you didn't know your father, they tell you you can't because your mama was a drug addict, they tell you you can't because of all the things that they say you can't. You tell them that's the old story. You come to write a new story of hope and possibilities. And so I challenge you. I challenge you. I dare you at double dog days, he says with kids. I dare you to step up, assume the leadership positions, to do what you can right here and now that will make a difference beyond your lifetime. So run on with your bad selves. Be ye not discouraged. Leaders are called for such a time as this. And so, my grandmother's favorite song is Walk Together, Children. And don't you get weary. I said, walk together, my brothers and sisters, and I say that without regard to race or class or culture or religion. Walk together, my brothers and sisters, and don't you get weary. The world needs your strength.